In the first video about Generation 4, we discussed a little bit about the transition from the reactors that we're currently using to Generation 4 reactor types, why we want to transition, how are they better, and what is the future going to look like for the nuclear industry. So in this video, we're going to focus more on the different types of Generation 4 reactors that exist out there and have been proposed. There are a total of 6 of them. We're going to analyze them based on the differences that they have compared to the current light water reactors that we're using, pros and cons associated with the different types, which countries are developing them, and at what stage of development they're currently at. Without further ado, let's get into it. Starting from the reactor types that we have the most experience in and moving on towards the reactor types with the least experience in, we're going to firstly discuss about sodium-cooled fast reactors, or SFRs. SFRs are operating on a fast neutron spectrum, and that is different compared to the ones we are currently using, since light water reactors operate on a thermal neutron spectrum. What the difference means is that fast neutrons have a better ability to fission uranium-238, which is not the case for thermal neutrons in light water reactors, the energy of which gives them the ability to fission the atoms of uranium-235 but not the uranium-238. In this case, having fast neutron spectrum provides a better fuel utilization for these types of reactors. The main difference between an SFR and a light water reactor is the fact that the coolant here is sodium instead of water. Using sodium as coolant allows the reactor to operate at higher temperatures, therefore be more efficient and produce more energy and subsequently electricity from this type of reactor. The country that is mostly pushing the development of SFRs is Russia, and they have 2 reactors that are currently operating, BN600 and BN800, that are sodium-cooled fast reactors, and they are building a BN1200, which is going to be operational in a few years. Another country that's also developing SFRs is China, with a CEFR, Chinese experimental fast reactor. Therefore, compared to what we will see in the different reactor types that we're going to discuss later on, for this reactor, we actually have hands-on operational experience, so we know how this reactor type works, how the sodium operates in combination with the rest of the structural materials as a coolant, and therefore that's very valuable in order to build more of those reactors in the future. Therefore, to summarize, for SFRs, they provide higher fuel utilization because of their fast neutron spectrum and higher efficiency because of the use of sodium as a coolant instead of water. However, they provide challenges because the sodium is there instead of water, and sodium can react with different materials, so this has to be taken into account when one is designing and choosing the materials going to be used inside the reactor. Moving on to the second type of Generation 4 reactors, and these are molten salt reactors, or MSRs. Molten salt are operating on a thermal neutron spectrum similarly to light water reactors, or even epithermal neutron spectrum. However, they use molten salt as fuel. What that means is that you don't have the typical fuel pellet and fuel cladding, rod assembly and core that we have in light water reactors, but the fuel itself is liquid circulating inside the core in the form of fluoride or chloride. This provides several advantages, such as online refueling, meaning that you can introduce new fuel, remove the spent one while the reactor is in operation, thus reducing the amount of time you need for the reactor to be shut down and maintained or refueled, and increasing the efficiency of the reactor and financial aspects of it, since you don't need to shut it down in order to refuel, so you can keep operating it while the refueling is happening. MSRs have also the potential to reduce waste produced by a nuclear industry by basically burning spent nuclear fuel. And one of the ideas for MSRs is the reactors that are going to use or will potentially use thorium as fuel in the future. Another advantage of MSRs is the fact that they can potentially reduce the waste that's being produced, since they allow for separation of different isotopes while the reactor is operating, meaning that you can separate the minor actinides or fission products that are not necessary for existing inside the reactor, besides just contaminating it and introducing issues, while at the same time you end up with a more cleaner fuel that keeps circulating, and you can always add more while the reactor is operating. Also, this is a reactor type that's being considered for thorium-uranium fuel cycle. So when we discuss about thorium reactors, typically molten salt reactors that are in question. The only real experience that we have with molten salt reactors is the molten salt reactor experiment, MSRE, in Oak Ridge in the US, and that pretty much is it. So not a lot of experience, especially when it comes to commercial applications. However, it is a technology that's being developed strongly by several countries such as US, Canada, China, and more. The countries that are developing MSRs are discussing for potential commercial deployment by 2030 or around that time range. So to summarize, MSRs, they provide higher fuel utilization and the potential to reduce the radioactive fuel waste that they produce by separating the isotopes that we discussed previously, and they also provide inherent safety features due to their passive cooling mechanisms. However, challenges associated with MSRs are materials development for the reactor conditions, which are very corrosive, since fluorides and chlorides are very corrosive materials that they will need to be inside the reactor. Therefore, one needs to develop materials that really withstand the corrosion that for the amount of time that they're going to be inside the reactor. And the last disadvantage of those is their limited commercial operation experience. Moving on to the third reactor type, and this is lead-cooled reactors, LFRs. LFRs will be designed to typically run in a fast neutron spectrum, providing the same advantages like we discussed in the sodium-cooled fast reactors. In this case, however, the coolant is lead. Liquid lead or liquid lead bismuth eutectic is going to be used as coolant in these type of reactors, and there is several advantages as to why this can be the choice. Lead is first of all very good at radiation shielding, so it really efficiently shields the radiation that's being produced, the radioactivity that's being produced inside the reactor from the fuel while it's being fissioned. And secondly, because it is very dense and it is very heavy, you can have a much smaller reactor size compared to a light water reactor with the same efficient cooling capabilities. Therefore, you can have SMRs that operate on lead as coolant. Lead also provides the capability to operate at higher temperatures, therefore being more efficient in terms of heat transfer. Several countries are developing the lead-cooled fast reactor technology, such as Russia and different European countries with projects such as Alfred. Sweden is also developing lead-cooled fast reactor technology with the lead-cooled company that is planning to build a lead-cooled fast reactor in Sweden by 2030. So to summarize, LFRs, they provide inherent safety due to their negative void coefficient, which means that in case of a loss of coolant accident, which is the most typical accident that happens in the nuclear industry, the rest of the materials, if the coolant is being lost, increase their capability in absorbing neutrons. Therefore, the fission reaction will naturally shut down and die off instead of increasing in temperature, potentially causing a reactor core melt. Another advantage of LFRs is higher fuel utilization, since the spectrum is fast and the heat transfer is much more efficient. The disadvantages that are associated with LFRs is, yet again, lead is a corrosive and erosive material, so a lot of materials development need to happen in order to have materials that we are sure that can withstand the environment of lead while in operation of the reactor. And last but not least, similarly to a few previous reactor types, here we're also lacking in operational experience of commercial lead-cooled fast reactors. Moving on to the fourth Generation 4 reactor type, and this is high-temperature gas-cooled reactors, HTGRs, and these are operating both on a fast and the thermal neutron spectrum, which provides versatility, which is one of their advantages. At lower temperatures, they operate in a thermal spectrum, while at higher temperatures, they operate in a fast spectrum. They have helium, which is a gas, as a coolant instead of water, and that gives them the possibility to operate at high temperatures, potentially producing hydrogen, which will be very beneficial, not only in terms of electricity production, but also covering a lot of other needs that the industry and the world needs in terms of decarbonizing the different types of industries out there. There is limited operational experience with HTGRs, mostly China is developing them with the HTGR-10 and HTGR-PM, which is under construction at the moment. The fuel that's going to be used inside these reactors is a triisotope particle fuel, and this is being developed in the US. It looks a little bit different than this reactor that we are using at the moment that has the pellet of uranium dioxide. This fuel is basically a sphere of three layers with different components and different reasons as to why they are there. They have the kernel, which is basically the fissile material, the fuel that is being fissioned, and then surrounded by a buffer and surrounded by another layer of shielding. I can go into much more detail and explain to you the triisotope particle fuel concept and how is that different from the fuel that we're currently using and how it is better and safer. And if you'd like to hear more about that, leave a comment down below and I'll make a video separately about this. To summarize, HTGRs, they are inherently safer since they have a higher thermal inertia. They have the potential for high temperature applications such as hydrogen production. However, they require a new type of fuel that is still under development, and their commercial experience is also very limited. Moving on to the fifth type of Generation 4 reactors, and we have supercritical water-cooled reactors, SCWRs. Maybe the word supercritical is a little bit of an unfortunate choice to put inside a reactor name, especially when you're aiming for a better and safer design. However, here supercritical doesn't refer to the reactor itself in terms of fuel, but it refers to the water. Supercritical water means that the water is in a state that is between liquid and gas, and you cannot really separate the two phases that much than you can in normal conditions that you know that it's either, for example, steam or it is water. That provides several properties that are beneficial for this kind of applications, hence supercritical refers to water and not to the reactor itself. Supercritical water-cooled reactors are at a very early stage of development. They are being developed by countries such as China, Canada, and a few more. And what they provide is basically a more simplified design than the LWRs that we have now, but in a better way, a more efficient way, utilizing the heat transfer and the power production than the current light water reactors because of the supercriticality of the water. They can operate both in fast and thermal spectrums, and due to their higher temperature and higher pressure and supercritical water conditions, they do provide the better heat transfer capacities and higher thermal efficiency. So to summarize, SCWRs, they provide a more simplified design than the light water reactors that we currently have, and provide the potential for higher thermal efficiency. However, they do pose challenges because of the high temperature, high pressure environment inside the reactor, and their commercial experience that we have is very, very limited. And last but not least, we have gas-cooled fast reactors, GFRs. Those run on a fast neutron spectrum and are mostly developed in France. They are at the early stage of research and are potentially going to be employed in 2040s. They use helium as a coolant, which is similar to another reactor type that we saw previously. And here, however, with a combination of a fast neutron spectrum, they provide efficient heat transfer capabilities and high temperature applications. So the advantages of a GFR is efficient heat transfer due to the high temperatures. They provide the potential for high temperature applications such as hydrogen production. And due to the use of helium, which is a very inert, non-reactive, stable element, they provide a very inert and safe environment inside the reactor, which contributes to inherent safety, which means safety that is by design inserted inside the reactor and doesn't need active components in order to keep the reactor safe under operational or out of operational conditions. The disadvantages associated with the design is the fact that we have no operational experience of those reactor types, and they are at a quite early stage of development at the moment. So understanding the different Generation 4 reactor types, the neutron spectrum based on which they're running, the coolant choice, why they are chosen to have the coolant that they have, and the stage of their development, the countries that are researching them and or already building them, is very important in order to get a general idea as to what Generation 4 is and at which stage of development are we currently are. However, as you can tell from this video, there is no perfect design, therefore there is several designs. There is no one design that's better in any aspect than the rest of the other five. There is properties that are better and worse associated with each design and each material choice. And the countries that have chosen to proceed with the designs that they have is mostly because they see the possibility to tackle the challenges and to try to solve the problems associated with this design that they could potentially not solve with the rest or are not interested in based on the application they are going for. Therefore, you can see how different countries are pushing towards different designs. Either one or several of them, like USA, has several designs that they're interested in. For example, Sweden is strongly pushing towards lead-cooled designs. And it is very interesting to see in the future which of them are going to be built, which challenges are going to be present, solved or not, and maybe perhaps a design will be abandoned and something else will be modified and introduced in the future. So it's a very exciting field and very new technology that the research for which is essential at this point in time. Let me know down in the comments below what you think, what is your favorite reactor type and why that is. If you have any more questions in depth about any of these reactor types that I can help you solve, I'll be happy to. Don't forget to like and subscribe and turn on the bell notification icon. It's been Elina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and until next time, see you soon.